Sooner or later, ISDN won't exist, so you may as well grasp the nettle now and stay one step ahead of your competitors by investing in IP infrastructure and, at a basic level, SIP trunking today.
I think, personally, there will be the replacement to ISDN. That's purely and simply because we're moving more and more to broadband Britain. So Tony Blair will get his wish. You've got to look at it from two perspectives. The first one is the manufacturer. The manufacturers, all of them, are moving across to actually provide SIP connectivity. And that's purely and simply a cost saving. Because if they can provide software instead of hardware, it's going to be more cost effective to actually sell, and they're going to earn more margin from the software that's being provided.
At a very basic level, it's a complete like-for-like replacement. It's only once the service is deployed and embedded in the customer's network that you can really start to overlay additional value to the proposition. I mean, customers want to save money, and that's why they look at SIP trunking.
Without doubt, as SIP trunks have taken off and as they will continue to take off, ISDN revenues will diminish, ISDN volumes will diminish. So there is a like-for-like replacement. But equally, we mustn't forget that SIP trunks bring things to the party that you can't do with ISDN. You can't get ISDN up and running inside 24 hours. You can't have total number flexibility with ISDN where you've got a Glasgow and a Manchester and a Leeds and a Truro number all going into a call centre in Norwich.
The question of whether a SIP trunking provider is better or worse than the other is negligible in my opinion. I think what sits around the service itself is what's key to the success of that service provider.
There is quite a fundamental difference between vendors' SIP products offering. Each person or each vendor has got a different platform. Those platforms can do certain different things. And so, it's based on the applications or the features that can be provided from each different application, which someone's either going to buy that product or they're not going to buy that product or service.
I guess the honest answer is yes. And the number one thing I would say is the main difference is actually not technology or technical. It's actually about size and scale of the companies. I'll illustrate that by saying that there are lots of providers of SIP trunks. There are not many large providers of SIP trunks with large installed bases.
A good SIP trunking provider provides reliable dial tone. So if you look at SIP trunking providers from an engineering perspective, there are vast differences in what's being offered out there. Now that's not necessarily good or bad, it's just a different way of delivering the service.
The other big difference, I think, between SIP services is fundamentally, you know, quality, QoS, SLAs. You know, some SIP trunks are out there on the market that have got that. You know, they are underpinned now with SLAs. They've got QoS. They can differentiate between the type of packet that's going across the network. They can interrogate the CPE on site and the router. Others, no. That it's buyer beware. It's best efforts. It works, and you take it, and off you go.
How long will SIP trunks take to become mainstream? I think there's only one history reference that you can go back to, and that's how long did ISDN take to become mainstream? Was it mainstream when it was DAS? Was it mainstream when it was Q931? Was it mainstream when it was I421? The way history repeats itself, I think that SIP connectivity isn't going to take 6 years to come into mainstream, but from probably it's got another 2 years before it comes into actually mainstream, where every channel partner is actually reselling it as part of their telephony application.
From a predictions perspective, there are a couple of things that really need to change for SIP trunking and IP telephony in general to really start to become mass adopted. And they are the cost and quality of the bandwidth that's available and the access and the concurrency of calls that you're able to push across the network. And when you've overcome those two barriers, I believe that a tipping point will be met where SIP trunking and IP telephony will be a no-brainer.